Welcome back, everyone, for episode 2 of Honor for the Fallen. This episode is titled The Wanderer. How's everybody doing today?
Excellent.
Yeah.
Excellent, Dan.
Yeah.
I gotta work later, so.
Oh, yeah, so this is kind of like
the calm before the storm. Not as good as I could be. Yeah.
Well, then let's cut right to it. Last week, you guys had encountered the mountain, which was a terrifying giant bear. And thanks to some clever oil work, Soggy and Sten were able to take the bear down quite a bit, while Pillwinkle actually has the honor for the kill, because he came around the corner like a little bitch and one-shot at him. Anyway, so we're actually going to start. It's been about an hour since you've slain the bear. All of you guys are outside of the cave. Sten, you're thumbing over the wooden figurine of the bear in your fingers. And as you're looking at this figurine, you are cursed with flashbacks of your parents' death. Soggy, you have helped Bjorn construct a skid that Scar's body is put on. And Bjorn has constructed a larger skid that he intends to put the bear pelt on. Do you want to be the one to skin the bear, Soggy, or do you want Bjorn to do it?
I don't want to do it.
All right. Now, Bjorn's idea to you guys right after the bear fell was that the pelt should be skinned and sent to the Jarl as a gift, and then the head should be taken back to the village. So his idea is you should take the head and the pelt. Does anyone have any objections to that?
I don't.
Excellent. Pillwinkle, I think this is the first time as you approach and you're looking at the bear's corpse. I will tell you that you've noticed that there's just something unnatural about it.
About the bear's corpse?
About the bear itself.
Should I do, like, a perception or nature?
You could do
a
nature. Yeah, you could do nature, investigation, perception, or survival check. I think any one of those will work.
Okay, I'm going to try
then. Now, Tipowitz, would it be safe to say that you're with your brother, or do you care if I put you in a different location to start you off?
I was thinking maybe I'm either, like, skulking around or I'm hovering over the dead body, like, kind of fuming over him.
If you're skulking around, I absolutely want to run with that.
Okay, yeah, I'm skulking. So, I'm like kind of stamping around the edge, like kind of muttering to myself. Like, my streamers are like, crazy. You know, going crazy on my head as I'm.
Fair enough. Oh dear, hang on a minute.
Yeah.
Did you just say chia?
I did.
I haven't heard that in forever. Okay. So, sorry. That being said, why is it not showing the rolls? There we go. Now it's showing the rolls. Okay. Tipowit, or Andrew, unfortunately we can't see it on XSplit because I accidentally just cleared it, but Andrew got a 7 in his survival check. Basically, what survival will tell you is that there's really nothing in the region that you think could have made this bear this large. Now, Sten, did you share the story of your parents with the fellows that went with you, or did you just keep it all quiet? Like, how the bear has been following you? Okay, good. All right, so let's move over. Pillwinkle, you're investigating the body. Now, you can make another check in a little bit when I come back to you, if you would like. Okay. Bjorn is kind of talking with you, and he's like, I'm happy, brother. Scar is now in Valhalla. He proved himself of great worth. And you, he points to the eye socket, flinging his knife around. Like, he's being really careless with his knife. Like, he just doesn't care. He's like, you slain the bear. with a shot most excellent. You should be proud.
I tell him that we should not celebrate just yet, because there's definitely something unnatural going on in the area that's causing the snow and that's making the bear this large.
I agree. We should also talk to your coward brother, who did not participate in the fight. It must be those books.
That's what I'm thinking, honestly. I'm still sure we might be able to sway him back.
Have word with him before Sten does. He nods to you.
I will.
Tipowitz, you step outside, and you kind of are skulking. You wander away from the group, not out of sight, just kind of like in the low tree area. And you notice something. The snow's dripping off the trees. The sun is starting to shine through the clouds, and already the snow is melting. And whatever doubt that you may have had, whatever anger you may have had, is temporarily subsided with the warmth of odor.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
these you may have been denied honor in this kill, but that is not how Odor sees it. Odor sees it as you were the messenger. And maybe that's your role. Maybe you don't share the same position in Valhalla. Maybe you have a more important role to fulfill for the gods. Because surely the seers and the great priests of all the lands, they don't go to Valhalla. They don't die in battle. Maybe there's a different fate that awaits you, and you're kind of warmed with this thought that you have been selected. When all of a sudden, you hear twigs snap at a bush nearby. Roll a perception! Sten, roll a perception. You hear the twig snap.
Oh, yeah.
Soggy, boy. Roll a perception. You hear the twig snap. Well, let's see if you hear it anyway. Nice! Tipowitz definitely hears the twig snap.
No.
Soggy, describe to me what you were doing to get a zero. I just want to know, how did your character not hear this twig snap? What's going on?
He's asleep.
I love it.
In the bear's fur.
So,
he's asleep with his eyes open.
The bear's still being skinned, but I totally imagine next to the skiff where Scar's body is like laid on it and wrapped up, because it's completely wrapped in cloth and tied and bound. Soggy's just sitting there like... Dorian, you hear a snap, and you look up, and it's coming from a small section of trees, like a small copse of trees and bushes that you know Tipowitz kind of wandered off to. Roll in intelligence. Or no, roll in investigation. This is entirely how you want to roleplay it, but your investigation does not deem that there's anything dangerous going on. But... there is a snap of a twig in the bushes where Tipowitz skulked off to. And you're kind of like the leader of this expedition. Your heart already kind of weighs heavy with the loss of Scar. Even though he did go to Valhalla, there's still a party that, you know, like, no man should be left behind kind of thing. Tipowitz, you turn, and there are three goblins looking at you. The first one lowers its spear on the ground and kind of holds its hands up, and then the other two are nervously rubbing their hands.
Okay, so I imagine I'm like standing in a sun shaft that comes down through the trees, and you know, because that's where I'm. That's what made me calm me down. So when I see the goblins, though, like my fire's almost reignited, but I see that it looked like they weren't trying to attack me, and that was really surprising. So I'll I don't think I speak any kind of goblin languages, but I'll just say in common, in Norse, I'll say yes, and I'll put my hand on my I have my quarterstaff, but I'll prepare it, I guess.
Oops. Okay, hang on, I'm making a roll to find out his intelligence real quick. The leader's intelligence. Okay. Excellent. So he's like, you realize now as he's shaking around, he seems to be some sort of shaman or druid. He's got twigs in his small tuft of hair he has in the top. His brown robes are strewn about with leaves and other natural elements placed into it. And you can tell that, like, seeds have been sewn into the hem of his shirt. So it looks very much like this guy communes with nature. And he's got a bear idol hanging off of the spear that he set down.
Can I do it, like, maybe an intelligence check to see if I can decipher any of the words that he used, his language that he spoke?
What other languages do you know?
Let me see here. I know Norse, Gnomish, Dwarven, Sylvan, English, French, and Elven.
Okay, so you know Elven. And Elven is an interesting language to know, because in this world, there's only one type of elf that is revered, and that is the Eladrin, the High Elves. The High Elves are seen to be Valkyries. You know, it is believed that they are the Valkyries that come down in battle. However, the other elves are mudbloods, and they are slaves, oftentimes totally enslaved by the Viking people. Now, the interesting thing about being a slave in the Viking culture is if you become friends with your owner and he really likes you and he thinks you're solid, he can just give you your freedom. It is a different kind of slavery than any other culture ever. Kublai Khan with Marco Polo actually shared the same kind of love. You know, he got Marco Polo in a trade with Marco Polo's father, thought of him as a slave, but within a year he thought of him as a son. And Marco Polo ended up becoming a magistrate in the Mongolian forces. So it's very much like that. There are elves with title, there are free elves, but the general impression of them is elves. Goblin is a dialect, like a rough dialect of elf. So if you roll a high intelligence, I will give you the basics.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I'm gonna hit that intelligence check.
Now, if you roll a 120, I'd like to remind you that Tipowitz and Pilwinkle, you both have honor points.
Terrible.
If you want to spend it, I'll let you roll again.
Yeah, I'll spend it.
Then count the first number on your second roll.
Just the first number. It has to be better than that, baby.
And just so you guys... Well, it was better.
but not by much.
All right, so just so Soggy and Stim Pokefist know, I'm also giving you guys honor points because you guys took the bear on, you know, like, face-to-face, and you weren't pussy-farting around about no un-Viking strategy. But charge. Keep that in mind, Pilwinkle and Tipowitz, I did not deny you honor points because you guys were playing. I'm not punishing you. It's just that what they did was very Viking. Does that make sense?
For sure.
Charge into battle, think later. That's very, very Viking. Alright, so, you have no idea, but it seems to you like they're either surrendering or they want to communicate. Now, I will give you with a 9 with your intelligence, you do know the druids speak druidic.
Yeah, so I'm definitely going to try to get my brother. I'll in the same way that the guy put down his weapon, I'll put down my staff. And I'll be like, I'll kind of give him a...
Like,
and I'll
an
say,
right
I guess I'll
back,
say,
kind of
like it. Yeah, I'll be right back. Yeah, and just one sec. And I'll kind of turn. I don't want to walk too far away, but I'll kind of turn and take a few steps towards the clearing, and I'll call out, Pilwinkle.
So Pilwinkle, you're inside the cave, and you hear Pilwinkle. Sten, you see in the bushes that you were looking at that you were like, oh, there's nothing there. You see Tippowitz kind of poke out and go, Pillwinkle, come here. Gotta show you something. Kind of like, you know, he has this look on his face like, Pillwinkle, where are you? I need my bro. Soggy, you are asleep.
Well,
actually, Soggy, you know, with him calling Pillwinkle, you probably open your eye. I don't imagine you're that terrible of a rogue that you just sleep while people are robbing you.
I'm just like,
well, if yeah. People didn't hear him, I'll point out that his Tippowitz is calling him.
Yeah, so you're by the cave, so you're like, hey, Tippowitz is calling you, and you hear it much louder now. You're like, Pillwinkle, Tippowitz is calling you.
I'll go over them.
Yeah, you step out of the cave, and the sunlight's the first thing you notice. The snow around the ground is actually starting to melt quite a bit. And lo and behold, right before you is Tippowitz standing outside this copse of trees. And to your left is Sten, who appears to be looking at a bear idol. And then Soggy, who's resting near Scar's body while Bjorn finishes.
So am I with Tippowitz yet?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I see the goblins.
Well, Tippowitz is standing outside the copse of trees, so he'd have to lead you.
Okay.
In.
Yeah. I'll as soon as you get close.
He might even
want to
be like, "Don't." In. Yeah, he might even want to say something to you before you guys go in the bushes. It's entirely up to you.
No, I'll just give him a look. Like, maybe if we have a look from back when we were. Still living together and like maybe with our dad, the look that we were going to get into mischief, and like we weren't trying to sneak away, we didn't want our dad to know. Like I'm gonna
okay,
give him that
okay,
look.
Okay,
like,
cool.
Oh,
Sten,
this is a secret.
Are you watching them?
Yeah.
Roll an investigation at advantage because you've been watching the entire thing the entire time. Soggy, when you hear them talking, are you interested? Like, are you peeking around and watching?
No.
Okay, so you're like, whatever.
It's like...
Yeah, Sten, something's up. Something's up, man.
Huh.
So they turn and they go into the bushes. What would you like to do?
I'm gonna go get Soggy's lazy ass up.
Alright, so you walk over to Soggy's... The... Do you, like, kick the bottom of his boot, or...?
Just kind of nudge him with my foot.
You're like, awake!
Yeah. Gnomes are up to something.
And do you just point at the copse of trees? Alright, so we're going to cut to them real quick. We're going to go back and forth. A lot of this is happening simultaneously, but we're going to go back and forth. Tippowitz, when you come into the brush with your brother, the one wearing the nature clothes is examining your staff. And when he sees you, he nods at you and then passes it back to you. And Pillwinkle, that's when you see three goblins. One of them is clearly a druid. You just know. You recognize the symbology sewn into his clothing. And two of the others are warriors, but they are unarmed. And they're all full. They're rubbing their hands nervously, like, what have we gotten ourselves into?
Okay.
And I'll say, as I take the staff, I'll say to my brother, and I'll say, let us show a little bit of caution.
I nod, and then I talk in Druidic to the Druid, and I say, what is your business here?
Oh, you are of one of the trees.
I nod.
It is a great honor to meet you. We've come to pay your thanks. You have freed us.
Freed you from what? The bear?
The mountain. My people have been starving. He's been eating all of the food in the area. Maybe now that he's gone, we can continue a healthy hunting culture again.
I thought your people worshipped him, the mountain.
No, we feared him. We carry the icons on our bodies so that when we looked at it, we would know, run, stay away from the mountain.
I tell Tempowitz what they've just told me.
My eyes get really wide, and I look happy though. I have a smile on my face because the sun had shined down on me, and now I'm like, wow, like Elder's grace is mighty.
We have come bearing a gift.
Okay.
He produces a battle horn.
I take it and examine it, and I show it to Tippowitz, and I say, "Do you have any use for this?"
And I'll look
as,
at it
as
and
you. Because to what the goblin sees is that you take it, and then you're like, and you're speaking your own language, and you pass it. Now, what language do you speak to Tippowitz when you talk to Tippowitz?
I'll speak Gnomish.
Oh, okay. Now, let's cut over to Sten and Soggy. So, Sten, you kick Soggy's foot, and what do you tell him? You're like, those gnomes are up to no good, or...
Yeah, just tell them that they're acting very suspicious for us during the battle and now after the battle.
Okay. Sorry, how do you feel about that?
Well, he tells me that, and I think that we should investigate.
All right,
I don't like
suspicious. Suspiciously?
he's the one who does all the suspiciously around these parts.
If anybody's going to be suspicious, for suspiciously, it's going to be me.
Nobody can out-suspiciarize the suspiciousiest person here. Alright, so... for fuck's sake. You guys want to roll stealth or just walk into the cops? The
I'm
going to
be sneaky,
trees.
Sneaky.
Alright, why don't you roll stealth? I'm going to say with Jimmy's stealth, because remember, you can help each other, so with Jimmy's stealth going up ahead, he gives Dorian advantage, because Dorian okay. has seen how the rogue is doing it, so, because I think
like,
this is important. I think this is not necessarily, like, story plot. If you fail, you fail. So, you guys are able to sneak into the bushes and peer in, and that's when you see these three goblins standing there, and they're speaking a different language with Pillwinkle, and then he produces the horn. And Pillwinkle and Tippowitz start speaking in goblin. So, if you guys are gnome, do you guys understand gnome? Gnomish?
I don't.
Okay. Well, in this world, it's an interesting thing. The goblins are a subspecies of gnome, much like how the orcs are a subspecies of elves. They are elves that have been tortured and, you know, imbued with the dark, dark passions of Loki, and they've been physically transformed and changed to match their heart. Goblins suffered a similar fate. They were a gnomish people that tried to take over the entire realm. And then ended up paying for it. So once you guys start speaking gnome, one of the warriors responds, but he speaks in a more ancient dialect of gnomish, but you guys can still hear it. And he's like, "It is the horn of the horizon call."
So they can understand us if we speak gnome?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Then I can just address, like, all of them. I don't just gotta talk to the druid.
The druid looks over at his goblin companion like, "You spoke out of line," and then looks back to you guys, and he says, "Yes. You blow this horn, and the goblins of my tribe will come to your aid should you need it if we are nearby."
I thank them very much for the gift. I say it's very generous. But I ask them, and I direct this to the druid, I ask him if he knows how the mountain could have gotten so large. As I've assessed, there's nothing in the region that would cause such an unnatural growth.
He looks nervous. "From what we can gather, it's a blood curse.
blood curse. And yes, do I have any, like...
If you roll a religion, you could find out if you know what a blood curse is. I mean, you're outside
are
of Viking society.
Are we all speaking in Gnomish
now? Yep. You could, okay. Tipowitz, also roll a religion. Now, you guys see that these gnomes are talking with the goblins.
Fraternizing with goblin enemies.
And they're like nodding their heads and stuff like that. And you can see that the druid's like gently handing Tipowitz's staff over. And it's all like tea time in the forest here.
I get angry. I'm like, thinking to myself.
We're fraternizing with the enemies.
Yeah. I hate goblins. What are you doing with goblins?
Now, are you saying that, or are you just saying it to yourself?
No, I was thinking it to myself.
Okay.
But I kind of I shoot Sven a look like, this isn't right.
So, what my character is thinking right now is, I don't know these two gnomes that, like, super well, but they haven't really caused problems. So we go to kill this, like, giant evil bear that's been, you know, hunting me my whole life. They're really nowhere seen during the whole battle until right at the end where they come in. Like, he puts it down like a mercy blow or something. And then shortly after the battle, they're in the woods conniving with goblins that ambush us on the road here. So from my view, these two little tricky guys are like traitors. So I think I'm gonna shoot these goblins.
Alright, so before you do that, you hear a small snap behind you.
Oh, it's
a small snap of a twig.
It's what's like his name?
Bjorn. You turn behind you and you realize that the goblins didn't just send three. There's about seven more, and they've all got spears, and they're just looking at you. They've got them up. They're like, What are you doing in the bushes? Like, they're looking at each other very confused.
How did goblins sneak up on me?
Well, that is kind of like their main ability. And they're not being quiet. They just literally walked into the copse, so you heard like the twig snapping.
Yeah. Can I roll an insight to see like their demeanor?
Yeah.
I guess. Is how they didn't just start throwing spears and arrows at us.
Yeah.
It's a trap!
Oops!
Soggy, you want to roll an insight?
I shoot him in the face. I strike them where they stand. I strike them down.
Do you? Or do you roll an insight?
I'm kind of just waiting for Sten to act.
Okay. At this point, like, Sten... One of them raises their hands, and you're like, oh, and you pull out your weapon, and it's got a rabbit on it, and they're motioning towards you.
Toward me?
No, towards Sten. They're like, look, I got food.
All right, I'm super confused. I'm like, what is happening?
All right, back in. Oh, go ahead.
Are they happy that we killed their friends? Do they know? Like, are they happy we killed the their bear god that they were worshipping?
The weird thing is, if goblins could smile, you think that's exactly what they're doing, and that kind of makes the situation more unnerving because they're just like,
it's creepy.
Yeah. So the rabbit
triangle
rabbit
face.
What was that, Soggy?
The rabbit's on a sword, like
no, on a cord. Like he's holding it out to you, like. Like, it's tied up, and he's like, take.
I'm gonna smack it on the ground and spit on it.
You do that, and they look at each other like their spears come down a little bit, and they're like, oh, check. And that's when you guys talking in the middle, the druid picks up his head as you guys hear, and the druid's like, someone's approaching. My scouts. And then he kind of wanders off into the bushes. And that's when he bumps right into, like, Sten's leg as he's coming through the bushes. Looks up and sees Sten and then sees everybody else. And just sees this dwarf, like, staring over a rabbit that's laying on the ground.
I got
and,
both my
and
hand
now,
crossbows
now that
out.
He's pushed his way through the bushes, everybody can see each other. Who are you aiming at? I'm just like...
The goblins, the gnomes, I'm just like... all over the place. And I'm like, what's going on?
Okay, so what I... Go ahead, somebody else go. Oh, I gotta look at something. I thought I had it, but I don't.
So we can all see each other?
Yep. Now you guys, the druid goblin kind of tore away the bush barrier.
I tell Sten to put his weapons down. I tell them that the goblins are friendly.
They weren't friendly on the road here. 2 hours ago.
See, they were bewitched.
They were bewitched by the mountain. They thanked us for freeing them from an oppressive ruler by killing the bear. I show him the horn that they gifted us, and I tell him that, you know, if ever we blow this, the goblins will come to our aid if we need them.
Sounds fishy.
Okay, so, yeah. Alright, I'll lower my crossbow slowly.
And, I tell him that I'm about to speak in Gnomish, but, you know, don't be alarmed. I'm just gonna tell him to chill. And then I speak to the goblins, and I apologize for the rude behavior of the rest of our party. I tell them that we've had rough run-ins with goblins in the past, and that they're a little on edge from the recent battle.
They nod, and one of the goblin warriors is like, "I was there at that battle. You fought with honor, ripped our men to pieces, but it was glorious." And then they all just go and put their arms over their chests. And then the druid nods and says, "Yes, we've done things for desperation because of starvation. The mountain has eaten all of the food in the area. Surely, you must have felt it if you live near here." And then the warrior goes, "They do. They live in a village by the river. After the battle, we scouted it out. Your farms, they are all frozen."
And I'll look, has Bjorn come up now?
No, Bjorn's in the cave going to work on the bear.
Okay, well, I'll keep my hold my tongue then. Well, actually, no, because Soggy's here, right?
Yeah.
And Soggy, like, tells people stuff because he's the bard, so. Yeah, I'm going to say, no, the light of odor shines once more. The field shall be fertile. And then I'll say,
perhaps... moment you mention Odor's name, they go down to their hands and knees.
Okay, so I like that, and I say, especially noting that, when they say that, I'll turn to them, and I'll, like, kind of show a little bit of respect as well. And I'll say, perhaps now that you are free, you can work together with the village and share the bounty of the forest for the bounty of the land that we claim, and we can thrive together.
The druid stands up on his, like, he kind of rises, and he says, "Well, we are cultivators ourselves. Come, we'll give you a place to stay for the night. Come."
I ask where they stay.
"We have a small settlement not far from here."
Ask if it's safe, first of all, because we've got members of the party that are wary of goblins.
"It is safe. I came from the settlement."
Well, then I guess I'll tell Sten and Soggy what they told us, to be, you know, that they're taking us back to the settlement, but that they ensured us that it is safe.
Taking the gnomes to Isengard. To Isengard.
That's when you hear, "Well, where is everyone? Hello?"
That Bjorn?
Yeah, you recognize Bjorn's voice.
Alright, I'm gonna go saunter over to Bjorn.
Yeah, you come out of the bushes, and Bjorn has this large skiff with the bear's head on it, and the pelt folded nicely. I had to remove sections of the pelt because Soggy ruined it.
Yeah.
It's all burned.
Fire does that.
It looks beautiful.
Yeah, actually, I think it does. Bjorn's like, perhaps we can give this to the Jarl as a gift, the bear pelt, or we could give the skull. Basically, Sten, because of what happened to your parents, you technically, by Viking right, have claimed to either one of these items. And the bear head, by the way, is friggin' huge.
Yes, I would like to display that in the tavern.
The main hall.
Okay, yes. Yeah. So you want to keep
the
bear head.
The Jarl couldn't have the rug.
I was thinking it would make a great cloak for the Jarl. He nods.
Looks like I hope he wipes his ass with it.
Me too, brother! And he, like, firmly shakes your forearm. Will, are we ready to go? We need to bury Scar.
There is a new interesting proposition that has cropped up. And I explained to him about the goblins and that how I am going to go along with them so I know where their settlement is.
He's like,
and to and to have the militia prepared for an offense for when I return.
Maybe I should go back to town then.
Yes. That would be good.
I will take Scar's body. Why don't you take the bear? Maybe the goblins will fear you.
Take the bear, like the corpse?
No, take the pelts that are on the skiff.
Oh.
It's on its own skiff. Skid.
Alright.
So yeah.
You
press on then.
Shake hands. They fare thee well for now.
And he lifts Scar up and he's like, come brother, let's take you home. And he goes down. And as you watch him leave, you realize that all the fog that was in the mountains the day before, and all the terrible weather, the terrible wind, it's gone. In fact, there's actually a nice, cool, not freezing, but a cool breeze on your face, and the smell of pollen in the air as you just go. And then you just kind of watch him disappear into the forest in front of you. And now the goblins all filter out of the woods, and that's when you realize there's about 35 of them.
Nothing I couldn't handle.
Obviously not. I mean, you guys destroyed 7 of them in, like, no time.
I've been taking all the damage. It's okay, guys.
you're like, rogue tank. All right, so, yeah.
Asian tanking.
Everybody comes out of the bushes.
Hook up the skiff to my back or whatever to pull it.
The goblins come over and they, like, pick up the sides to help you. In case there's rocks that you get stuck on, they, like, lift it. There's enough of them that they can easily help. Okay. So the druid's like, come, and leads you on. One of the goblins looks down at the rabbit, picks it up, shrugs, and then takes it with him. Looks at Soggy,
we're
like.
Now.
It's got some soggy seasoning on it.
Are we like going to the settlement now?
Yeah, they're getting ready to lead you now. It takes about 8 hours. And mainly the reason why it takes you that long is because there's a lot of switchbacks up a rocky cliffside. I mean, this landscape almost looks like the rocky canyons of Mars, but instead of red, it is black stone. And you guys go up this vexing series of tunnels and stuff until they lead you into a small cave system. And once you come out of the cave, it opens up into what looks like a crater in the mountain range. But it's not covered by anything. And in this crater, there's beautiful trees. Birds are flying around. There's no sign of wildlife, but you know that that's probably because there's been a shortage. And there's all of these little Ewok-style huts built in the trees. And these goblins are all patrolling around it. And as you guys are going through the cave, you realize that on one side of the cave, there's a giant iron gate. And on the other side of the cave, there's a giant iron gate. So it kind of seals their community off when need be. And
Tipowitz is impressed.
The druid, very excited, goes, "Oh, come with me, come with me, come with me." And leads you over to the small wooden door that's built in the face of the cliffside that surrounds the town.
I'll go.
And he looks at Sten, who is clearly of the rain-drain type. And says, you too, you'll love this. But to you, Sten, you just hear,
thinking to myself, goblins.
Yeah, and Sten, I think you and Soggy should roll an investigation, because you guys are the ones who are not so on board with this. Or a perception.
Well,
your choice.
Beautiful.
What about you, Soggy?
I got an
investigation,
okay.
Or perception? Investigation. Yeah, I think that's actually pretty good. Oh, come on. Oh. Hey! Oh. Alright, so... Soggy, you're like, there sure are a lot of trees here. And Sten, you look up and you see that on certain sections of the crater, there's a small little... A small little rope pulley system that goes up to the top of the wall. And buckets. And what you notice is that the goblins get in the buckets, and then somebody at the bottom goes, wee, 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 and it, like, lifts the goblins up to the top of the wall, where they're standing on guard, patrolling the outside. They don't look like they have any weapons that they could use to throw down the wall at anybody who's approaching. They only have spears, but they're definitely got scouts around. So, on a clear day, there's no approaching this area without being seen. And he leads you guys to the door, and he opens it, and the smell of poop comes out of the door, and he's like, "Come on, come on," and he goes inside.
I'll look in the door before I go in. Is it well lit in there?
Pillwinkle, I will say that Pillwinkle, you are not bothered by the smell.
No, no way.
Yeah.
I go right in.
Yeah, so Pillwinkle goes right in. Tipowitz, you kind of poke your head in. Sten and Soggy, when this wafting smell of odorous shit comes out, do you guys continue to approach? I think you're muted, Soggy.
I said it doesn't surprise me. I expected to be smelling this already.
Oh, okay, so you just kind of go in. What about you, Sten? Yeah.
So we're still outside of this crater?
Yeah, you guys went in the tunnel to get inside the crater, and then around the inside of the crater is a stone wall. A natural stone wall.
Oh, okay.
So you're going to... You're inside the crater, but you're going up to one of the stone faces that has a wooden door built into it.
Thank you. Right. The forest crater.
Yeah, so you yeah. It opens, you guys walk right in, and that's when, Tipowitz, you look to the left, and you see boxes of fertilizer running, probably 14 boxes in this one main room. But this room is huge. It looks kind of like a warehouse. It expands really wide, and you see all these goblins toiling around. these tables that are full of boxes full of dirt, and on top of the dirt, mushrooms are growing. And they have a lot of mushrooms.
Wow. I'm huge.
And now you realize why it smells like poop.
Yeah, I'm even more impressed now. This is awesome.
And they're like, we cultivate. We are not merely only hunters.
I tell them that I'm impressed with their yield here, especially since the weather's been so bad.
Well, cold and dark is good for mushrooms. And the fertilizer creates the humidity they need. And he motions to the walls. But our soil can't even grow a simple potato, let alone a carrot. So we've been living on a diet of mushroom stew, which is just water and mushrooms.
Better than rock soup.
Well, yes, like I said, my friend, we should work together, and we can all live more easily through the works of our combined tribes.
He nods, and then he turns.
We need not
back.
Be enemies.
He says, "Would you like to meet the chieftain?"
I'll kind of get taken aback, and I'm like, "I'm no envoy. I can't speak for my tribe."
Is your envoy?
I look at Pillwinkle, and I'm like, I gotta give him that look, like. What do we do now, man? They want to talk to Dad.
I tell them that
they can't help but look at Sten, and I'm gonna paint a picture for you. You've got two gnomes, a dwarf, and then a tall human. So immediately their eyes just go to the tall human, like he must be Big Boss Man.
I turn to Sten and say that. They want you to meet the chieftain.
And I'll turn and say, perhaps we can make an agreement between our peoples so we can get some of these mushrooms in exchange for some of our goods.
Has the village been attacked by goblins before, or are they pretty scarce?
No, actually, the goblins never approached the village. They stayed on their side of the river. It's always been one of those things that you guys have always had squabbles when going onto their land. Your hunters don't even really go onto their land as much. But that's also because nobody goes to that mountain range. You know, if you remember, if we look at our beautiful map, which I'll go ahead and move us over to. The mountain range is fairly isolated from anything important. I'm letting it load because apparently this image is huge.
Huge.
But they're called the Breivik Highlands. So I'm going to move you guys over to the map so that you can see it. Have to fix that. I'll probably edit the picture and post-edit so that people can see it. But north of Skalaholt, you guys don't really go because above the mountain range is the Forest of Mystery, and it's called that because nobody knows what goes on up there. Like, what happens in that forest seems to defy the laws of nature. It's one of the reasons.
In the forest stays in the forest.
Pretty much.
Huh.
But the goblins never travel south of that river. They're pretty content in staying in the Breivik Highlands area. But it's an interesting position for Skalaholt because you need to go north to hunt. If you go south, you step into the realm of your Jarl, who is at Olafsvellir. And in Olafsvellir, they don't tolerate that shit. You're hunting on their lands. They're like, excuse me, back the fuck off. And then to the west of Skalaholt is Spiderthick, which is a forest full of giant spiders. So people usually...
Do I know about that whole hunting situation? What I know about that? Like, how the land is kind of contested up there, and we also kind of need that land?
I don't think you would care too much about politics to know, nor are you...
No.
Do you travel outside of town? No. I mean, you know that...
No, if it's not in a book, I wouldn't know about it. I was just going to try to implore Sten to maybe use that as bargaining as well, but if I wouldn't think of it, I am not gonna look at
that. Well, I would say that you know that I would say that you know that hunting's tough because so many people have claimed the area, but I would not say you know who or what the boundaries are. You know, you'd be the guy who goes, "Why can't we go west?" And then Sten would be like, "The spies."
Well, my intelligence is high enough that I would think, you know, I guess, and when I'm trying to convince somebody who's reticent, I'll use any possible plan. So I'll also say, when I tell them, you know, maybe we can get them to give us mushrooms for some of our grown goods, I'll say, and maybe we could you know, get them to let us hunt around their area without conflict. You know, they could come around and we wouldn't have to kill them. That's all I'll say. Just
but
add that in,
because
I know you the ranger likes to hunt, so maybe we'll sway him more than get some mushrooms.
Okay.
I fucking hate mushrooms.
So, Sten, it looks like Hillwinkle and Tippowitz are presenting cases to you of why we should totally do this.
I will meet with their chieftain.
Alright, so you get taken to a longhouse that's built up in the trees. All of the goblins gather like it's a huge celebrity thing. They see the bear corpse, and they're like, "Woo, woo, 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 woo!" And they're like holding the spears above their heads, and children are laughing, and they're running out, and they're slapping the bear's face, and then they're running back into the crowd, like, "Take that, bear!" And a lot of the men are coming up, and they're like trying to shake your guys' hands if you shake their hands, but it just looks like they're all freaking celebrating. One of the women come up, and they've got a necklace made out of hemp rope that has baubles and beads hanging off of it, and they put it around Pillwinkle's neck. And, you know, everybody's just kind of a big buzz. And as you go through, it's kind of like the Munchkins in Munchkin Land and Oz. As you pass by, the crowd filters in behind you. So you're being followed by a big crowd of happy goblins.
Nice.
So I would say like I'm raising up, I'm like, really, I love that. And maybe Pillwinkle's like, "Oh shit, people everywhere."
Well, yeah, but these are his people. These are like nature people.
Yeah.
Like they're all one with nature. They're not about war, or they don't really have any like metalworking going on. All of their spears are stolen. But they come up. You guys come up to a large tree. This tree is massive. It sprawls to the heavens, hidden by the mountaintops, but it sprawls to the heavens. Tippowitz, roll a religion. We can't hear you.
Okay, no problem. I'll pull out my right. I'm on the long section of the sheet. Religion, boom. There you go. That wasn't that good.
All right, you're like, "Wow, this is an impressive tree. Must be a gift from the gods." And you approach, and up, resting on one of the lofty banks of the trees, or branches, not banks, it's not an ocean, is a large longhouse that's sprawled across it. Like, if my arm were to extend, it's kind of sprawled along the length of it. And there's a very large elevator that's built out of a series of pulleys and ropes sitting, and it's kind of like a hollowed out tree trunk, and it's sitting on the ground waiting for you. And there's mountain goats with harnesses on them that operate the elevator. So the goblin druid motions to the elevator.
Very ingenious.
I like unhook the skiff or whatever from me and hop aboard the elevator.
All right. Does everybody go?
Yeah.
Soggy, what about you? Yep. Are you going up? Cool. So
not easily, but yeah.
You guys go up, and one of the goblins One of the goblins... okay, I'm going to give you disadvantage as long as we're up there. he whips out a stick, and he's like, "Acha-cha-cha-pacha." And what you guys hear... Well, no, no one speaks goblin. So he just starts smacking the goat's ass, and the goats are like, and just start moving forward, and the entire thing rises up. It jerks up at first, but then it actually rises with quite a lot of speed as these goats are going around in a circle pulling this pulley. Up and up and up and up. You know, now you're up at the regular tree canopy, and you're still going up, and then that's when you get to the floor of the longhouse. You realize the longhouse oversees the entire... forest that's within this crater.
Is there a goblin bard playing elevator music?
He's like, bow, 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 bow. No.
Oh. Useless creatures.
So yeah, you get up to the top. And before you is these double doors to this longhouse. This longhouse does not look goblin built. I mean, it's built out of the same materials they built their homes with, but it doesn't look like a hut. This looks like a proper longhouse.
Also, probably built by men or their kin.
What is that supposed to mean?
Or gods. I mean, is it that quality of workmanship? Can we roll on that? Maybe looks, an investigation? Or?
Well, I mean, you could have rolled a religion, but you failed it.
Okay, fair enough.
But you could roll a perception.
Somebody else could roll on that. I mean, let's let somebody else do that roll.
Yeah,
man.
Pilwinkle That's could straight. Even do a religion roll. He's a religious dude.
Yeah, I might try that.
Soggy, if you roll... an investigation.
Okay.
You've got a bonus to it.
I will investigate.
Andrew's like, they put a house in the trees? This is unholy. Okay. So, Soggy, you definitely recognize, like, the shape of the dragon and stuff to have been carved by a civilized people. So, definitely not these goblin pond scum.
They stole it.
They stole the longhouse and they brought it up to this tree.
They used their goats to pull it to these great heights.
But before you is a set of double doors. And I would say that coming off the elevator, there's probably a little walkway and then a small porch with chairs, but the chairs are empty. So you guys could sit on the porch and smoke your pipe tobacco. And then there's these vast... double doors in front of you.
Oh, in that queue.
But it's wrong.
But it's wrong! So, did he say anything about the long hall being made by men or whisper or anything like that, or just kind of keep it himself?
I don't know, Soggy. Do you whisper your findings to Sten? I would think probably Sten, because you guys are probably in the back with each other, like, oh my god.
Yeah. Uneasy.
You guys are the pessimists.
Yeah, I'll play that to Sten. Like,
now, I will allow Pilwinkle and Tipowitz to roll a perception to see if they hear that that right. announcement.
I block those rolls.
Pilwinkle definitely hears Soggy go, this was built by a civilized... Archie, you even hear Soggy. Actually, Soggy, roll stealth if you want to be quiet. That's a better idea. And if you roll nat 20, Sten didn't even hear you. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, okay. So Andrew does hear it, but Tipowitz doesn't. So Pilwinkle's like, oh, interesting. Tipowitz is like, we sure are high up.
I'm just enthralled by the beauty. I'm like, wow, amazing.
There are
I'm looking for every strand of light.
There are depictions of like Odin and Thor fighting off the demons of the battlefields on the door.
Yeah, that fully has my attention.
Okay, so as we're walking up to the double doors, I'm thinking to myself, what happened to the original owners of this place?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Pondering what these little sneaky goblins might have done.
So do you swing the doors open?
I check for traps.
Roll an investigation.
Oh, no, seriously, really, if you want... Traps.
Oh, okay.
I mean, if they trap...
There might be a flying...
Place.
There might be a pit under a welcome mat and a brick wall behind the door and some meat traps hanging from the sides.
What kind of sick bastard would do that?
And a sign that says, don't enter this house.
Full of traps!
So, you swing the door open... And it's just, they're heavy double doors, so you gotta be like, push them open with your hands. And before all of the party members, a dragonborn sits on a wooden throne, and in front of him is a long fire that runs down the length of two long tables that flank it. So basically, you guys could sit at the long tables, and in the middle of the table is this fire that extends the width of it. And he raises his hand and he says, come in. And that is where we're going to take our first break. Definitely join us for part two so we can find out who the heck this dragonborn warrior is. Thank you very much.